All right. Very great. Once again, we're here making the supreme effort that only those who realize that the only problem we have is the continuity problem, only those can make the supreme effort. Because they realize, wow, there really is only one problem I need to resolve, not billions. And so then you realize, I can do that. I can solve this one problem. I can resolve this. It's just a matter of evaporating it. Whereas if you think there's just, you know, millions and millions of problems, you think that God created spirit is imperfect, incomplete, it needs to become, it needs to evolve, it needs to grow, it needs to learn, it needs to complete itself. If you believe all that, then it seems like, wow, this is going to take forever. And you don't get intense about it. But if you realize there's actually only one problem, just a simple continuity problem, but it's very severe, simple but severe, then you say, wow, let's go to work on this. I've got some motivation now. So this is what happened to me in 1978, around this time in 1978, in late October, early November, or through November. There's a time frame there in the summer of 78, going through the beginning of January of 79, where everything happened and I woke up and I realized it was only a continuity problem, it's the only problem there is. And then I realized that I would be submerged by it again, the continuity fear. I said, okay, I'll just go to work on it. So this accounts for the workaholic nature. Why? Because I realized there's only one problem to solve. That's it. Nothing else. Need give no thought for anything else. Now, I came across a website. And it had some fairly recent articles, transmissions from Dr. Brent Haskell, purporting to be Jesus speaking through Dr. Brent Haskell. And some of them I hadn't read before. I mean, there's a couple. I said, wow. So there's a few essays or few transmissions from Jesus, Yeshua, or whatever they want to say, to Dr. Brent Haskell. And so I read those. And that's helpful. But I always wonder, how come Jesus never answers the questions that I want to have answered, right? You read A Course in Miracles, read all these books, and you say, you know, I've got a million questions, actually, or other questions that never addressed at all. Never addressed at all, really. So I was thinking, you know, maybe if Jesus just showed up, it'd be better just to say, don't say anything. Don't say anything. Don't answer any questions. And I was looking on the internet, and there's all these channelers or people supposed that they've talked to Jesus, they're talking to them. And it's all, you know, just you read it and you say, wow. that's interesting, huh? That's not Jesus. So what if Jesus just showed up and didn't say anything? That'd be really cool. It'd be fair, right? Because I tell you, whatever he says, there's a ton of people out there saying, hey, how come he didn't answer my questions? How come he didn't address what I feel is really, really important? And, you know, all that work, he hasn't addressed what I would ask him. He hasn't addressed those questions. But it's not important, really. It's not that important. So maybe Jesus just be here and just be quiet. Say, forget it. Don't say anything. Don't need to say anything. Because this is a journey beyond words. Okay, why is this a journey beyond words? It's a journey beyond words because what is, which is isness, all is, isness is, this is God, isness is. Within isness, there is no sense of opposites whatsoever. Not even the hint of opposites or opposition. Not even the slightest trace of it. And so there's absolutely no need for words whatsoever. You can't express this in words. Cannot be expressed. So literally, we cannot express in words or concepts reality. We cannot express it in words or concepts. Not possible. Not possible. Even if we say one, the possibility of two-ness arises. But the experiencing of reality, there is not a trace of any possibility of otherness arising. No otherness, no opposition. Nothing, not even a hint of that, not even a suggestion of it. So that's why when we experience reality, we may say, well, wait a minute, how do I put that into words? You know? Why do we say that? Why do we feel we need to put into words? Well, as Jesus points out, this existence is the result of us trying to reverse the direction of creation, trying to be greater than God, trying to make effect cause and cause effect. So we want reality to be the creation of concepts, of words. We want words to be the cause and reality the effect. So when we experience reality, we say, wait a minute. Now, how was this caused again? What kind of words did I use to cause this? What kind of concepts, what kind of opposites, play of opposites did I use to arrive here? This is, you know, how did I arrive here? You start thinking this, okay. And this is duality, this is the trap. And this is what we've been talking about in these videos. Oh, man, I just made some Ovaltine. I haven't tried Ovaltine in a long time. I put it in water. Not a good idea. It's not the real Ovaltine I remember. It's sort of powdery. The old Ovaltine was like granular, sort of like, looked like it was baked or something. And this stuff is terrible. It's terrible. Ah, no taste. Gosh. Kind of like existence, no taste. What we call existence is a semantic issue. I call this delusion existence, and reality is-ness. So is-ness is not a product of existence at all. Not at all. So if Jesus shows up, it's better to say nothing. Now, we already have got his basic explanations, which are very helpful. But at some point, it might be helpful if he just didn't say anything. Didn't address any questions. The question is, how did reality arise from existence? How did isness arise from existence? Is an insane question. It didn't arise from existence. No, and to say, well, how didn't it arise from existence is also insanity. And so we're right back to the central focus here. Now, Jesus said a lot of good things in what I read. I didn't agree with everything. That's fine. You don't expect when you're using words that you're going to agree with everything. It's just not possible, actually. So you just have to cut, whenever someone is using words, you have to cut them some slack. Because it's going to clash, it will clash with your words and your concepts. It's inevitable. It's inevitable. Although I have to say that Longchenpa's spaciousness doesn't seem to clash with me hardly at all. It's quite interesting. But still, there is unsettledness there. There is unsettledness because you're still thinking in concepts, and we're still thinking, how can I get these concepts to? How can I find what created creation? That's what we're asking here. How we're searching for what caused isness? What caused isness? How did we cause it? That's what we're searching for. How did we, spirit, cause isness? And so, as for instance, Punjaji says, call off the search. Stop searching. We're searching for what caused isness. Nothing caused isness. We didn't cause isness. God caused isness. Cause caused isness. Effect didn't cause isness. And so when we experience reality, then we think, well, how am I going to go back and explain to everyone who and appear to be a teacher to them, because they expect a teacher to be able to tell them where to find the answer to this question. And what I would say is the wrong question. But then they would say, well, you just don't know the answer, that's why. There is no answer. What do you mean, don't know? There's not a question of not knowing the answer. To say I don't know the answer means there is an answer. There isn't any answer to the question, how did existence create isness? It didn't. That's the answer. And again, they'll say, well, how did it manage not to? It didn't manage not to. And then they say, well, wait a minute, you say it didn't manage not to, so that means it did. And that's what's called level confusion. Okay, circularity. Okay. So, just noticing this is very important. The ability to look at this without all get freaking out is very important. You don't have to do anything about it, just notice it. So, again, we are asked, the world will ask us, so what caused, how did existence cause isness? It didn't. Really? It didn't? No. Well, how did it manage not to cause existence? It didn't. And they say, wait a minute. So it didn't manage to not cause existence. That means it must have caused existence. So you're mistaken in the first place, right? So it must have caused. So how did it cause? This is circular. See, it just goes around and around and around. Immediate frustration, immediate disconnect. This is level confusion. This arises from continuity fear. This is what each one of us has to realize. We don't need this. We don't need to get tripped up on this. So at the root, I feel, at the very root of our troubles is this trip up. And we think, oh my God, how do I deal with this? How do I deal with this? Wow. Well, how does that, we realize we don't need it. Because our continuity fear has been evaporated enough so we don't need it. But we think that we're supposed to find an answer to the circular reasoning. There is no answer to it. And then we think, well, we're dumb. Not having an answer to no question, how is that dumb? Reality doesn't have any question to it. So there is no answer. Reality has no answer to it at all. What could need an answer? An answer to reality doesn't have an answer to it. We don't need to have an answer. Neither to how did existence create isness? It did not. And then they say, oh well, how did it manage not to do it? They say it did not manage not to do it. And then they say, well, that means it must have managed to do it. No, it means no in both cases. It didn't do it. It didn't manage not to do it. And it didn't manage to do not doing it. Right? And it goes on and on and on, infinite regress. And we may be saying, well, why is this important? How come Jesus isn't answering us to say, well, you know, what do we need to do about the planet and the ecosystem? How come we can't get answers and blah, blah, blah? It's infinitely better to look at this trap, this mental trap that seems to be, you know, impassable for us like this. So I try to bring it up whenever possible. I don't always remember what it is. So when we're able to remember what this is and see it, it's super auspicious, actually. So drop everything else. If you're able to see this, what I've just spoken of, forget everything else. Forget any answer Jesus ever gave or anyone's ever taught. Forget it all, drop it all. So, whoa, wow, just focus just on this. Focus, I mean full stop. Just stop everything. Full stop. Again, we will be asked, you experienced isness? Yeah. How did existence create isness? You must know. You must have gotten the answer. See, there's no answer. No, didn't create existence. Existence didn't create isness. So there's no answer to there. And then the next thought will be, well, how did it manage to not create existence? If it didn't create isness, how did it manage to not create isness? It didn't do that either. How did it manage to create isness, and how did it manage to not create isness? Okay? Now just sit quietly here, and don't go flying off into any other direction. My mind has been full of thoughts all day, thinking, considering, breakthroughs, etc. But this is more important than all of that. Because everything is a variation on this, and a play on this. And then they'll say, well, you can't answer that? Okay, well, let's go to work then. Let's find an answer. Answer to what? There's no question there. The answer is, you will go to work on this. So what we're saying is, don't go to work on it. Full stop means don't go to work on it. Stop the work. Call off the search. Both the search for what how did existence create isness, and the search for how did existence manage to not create existence? How did existence not create it? Isness. How did existence not create isness? So the two questions to search for: how did existence create isness, and how did existence not create isness? This is the dualistic prison, the trap, right here. So I wasn't expecting to talk about this at all on this video. Not at all. I had 100 other things I was going to speak of. When this came up, I just thought, oh my gosh, drop everything else. This is the pearl of great price right here. So people are stuck on, our minds are stuck on, spirit is stuck on, either or. Which one is it? Did we create isness, or did we manage to not create it? Or if we, yeah, which is it? So you say we didn't create isness. Well, how did we manage to not do that? As if we had the power to do so, but somehow we managed not to do it. Somehow we prevented ourselves from doing it. How can we prevent ourselves from doing the impossible? This is, I'm surmising, but it just a thought occurred to me, or a consideration. Some of these teachers, who later on we realize that they really aren't up to snuff. They may have got this realization: hey, I didn't create isness, but I managed to not create it. And so they're inflated with this sort of pride, spiritual pride, like, hey, I managed to not create existence. So I'm very important. But then they also, the counterpart of that is, they could always say, well, I think I'm going to actually create isness. I'm actually going to create isness. That'll throw the whole thing into turmoil. So you better. Just a consideration, but I feel that this is very possible. Which is why someone like a Ramana Maharshi, legit, okay, very legit, and very silent, wasn't he? You felt like he doesn't have any answer. He doesn't need any answer. No answer is needed. And he's just showing us that. And that's a far cry from some of these neo-Advaitin teachers. And you wonder, what's going on here? If they're teaching the same as Ramana Maharshi, well, you know, how come I'm not feeling it's the same? Maybe they taken the position of, hey, I managed to not create isness. Okay, all right. So we just look at that. Full stop with that. And this is quite a burn, full stop in the burn, as I say. This is shaking up the full foundation. But this is why we come here, is to have our foundations rattled, have our cage rattled, have our minds staggered. It's an ordeal, sweat lodge type ordeal almost. I've never been in an actual sweat lodge. I've been in saunas, certainly. Pour the water on the heater and the steam. I love them. I can handle it. I said, wow, this is great. What an ordeal this is. So this here is an ordeal. This is really straining the very foundation here. And we need not go into any elaboration on it. This is important. The less elaboration, the greater the strain. In the experience I had of a non-dual abidance, opposites were impossible. You cannot think that way. You cannot conceive that way at all. There's no way it could be put into words, actually, at all. Which is where Ramana said silence is the best transmission of all. Maybe that's why Jesus never gives me the answers I ask. Nothing, doesn't say anything. Maybe just being silent. Maybe that is the answer. I always ask for answers. This question, nothing, 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 nothing ever comes. I say, wow, what's up? Maybe just silence is the answer. Now Jesus did say that as you awaken, you get all these little moments, glimpses. And he says those like form a chain, as it were. And then eventually that chain is like complete. This is what I've experienced. Many, many, many glimpses of awakening, just momentary glimpses. And he says that's actually how it works. And then eventually the chain is complete and there's nothing that can be said about isness about reality. Nothing can be said about it at all. Nothing meaningful can be said about it. Because there is no contrast, there is no other, there is no other situation. There isn't any situation that can arise. That, you know, words are inherently come from, words are not native to isness at all. They're native to the attempt to change isness. So, I think that I would say that part of, we're so addicted to words that when we don't get an answer, say, how did we cause isness? And we expect a long, complicated answer. We can, oh, good, be reassured. And we say, we didn't. And then they say, whoa, wait a minute, I need words, I need words. Well, how do we manage to not do it then? Explain that to me. So they want some explanation, you know, like that. That's also part, maybe part of it. Because they feel that words are causative, that thoughts are causative. Jesus says thoughts are not causative. Thoughts that we're thinking with a brain are not causative. That's why we try to tell mountain, move, it doesn't move. But we like to think, okay, we experience reality. Then let me think, okay, what are the thoughts that cause that? What are the thoughts that could cause that? There aren't any thoughts that could cause that. Isness is the one thought, is thought itself. It doesn't need thoughts about it. It is the word, as some archaic traditions call it, the word. But again, we need not elaborate too much. It's just, I feel that the trepidation is already here. It's just like, we found out the secret. You know? And it's the jitteriness is here already. Found out the secret. And you know, so many people love these teachers who have an inflated spiritual pride of saying, hey, I managed to not create isness. I managed to not create isness. I'm super, you know, superior to those who are seeking to how they created isness. I managed to not create isness. So many, 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 many people flock to those sort of teachers. And they take great comfort in that. Because it still is, well, it's self-evident that, now, when we see through this, it creates a shock. Staggers the mind, goes, whoa, I won't be able to go see those teachers anymore. You say, I might get a real teacher now. I might actually abide in, I'm actually be a teacher myself. So, scares us. Actually be like Ramana, we think. Well, we might. And since there's no question or explanation to give, the mind is quiet. We cannot explain how we how existence created isness, because it didn't. And we cannot explain how it managed to not create isness, because it didn't. And we cannot explain the circularity of this, because it isn't circular. So there's no explanation to give. So we experience Ramana as this quiet stillness, without any ripple, without interruption. No searching, no explanations, no questions, no answers. So I was expecting to go off on a different tangent in this video, but this is better. This covers more territory, for sure. Anytime we can get clear about this, this is super helpful. Now, of course, I wish that I could do this more often, but it's a blessing when the clarity comes like this. It's not easy. It's the result of a lot of work, of evaporating the continuity fear. Add chocolate and powdered cocoa to your list of do not use, because I decided I'm gonna have some chocolate milk. I just felt like I wanted to have that, and I haven't had that in so long. So they said put 3 heaping tablespoons of this chocolate powder in hot milk. So I really heaped it on. I said, wow, this is gonna be a real rich chocolate drink. Big mistake. I hardly slept a wink last night. So, gosh, couldn't sleep. It wasn't as bad as caffeine. My mind wasn't racing. I just couldn't sleep. Chocolate has some capacities like that. Very much a very powerful, actually. So that's why I went for the Ovaltine. But gotta use milk for Ovaltine. This is not good. Existence. Drinking water-based Ovaltine as existence. Wow. So the question is, how long will we keep drinking that? Now, we may think we have to get rid of all these, what you call them, what kind of teachers in non-effective teachers, or whatever you want to call them. No, we just have to get rid of our need for them, our attraction to them. That's a lot easier. A lot easier. So, the Holy Spirit has been telling me all this time, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, don't. And for the most part, I haven't. And I just said, okay, forget it. Just stay away from that. Let's not go on a crusade against this and this teacher and that teacher and that teacher. You know, the numbers are legion. No, just work on releasing any need for those teachers. No need, no traction. You're free of that. Free of it. Without having to go on any crusade at all. And, of course, those who go to such teachers are desperate, of course, to out of severe continuity fear. It's very severe fear. And so they're desperate to protect the reputation of the teachers and how this teacher is legit. And if you know, are trying to pull them down, you know, the followers will pull you down, you know, for sure. They want their idol, you know, absolutely. idolaters are very protective of their idols. So maybe there's some sort of thinking of a thought of bliss that, oh, I didn't, existence did not create isness. Wow, this is wonderful. Then you fall into, wow, how wonderful I am. I managed to not create existence. Still, you're still believing in greater than God. It's the same game. Same game. You're saying, well, I could have, but I didn't. Very benevolent. See, very benevolent, very kind, very considerate, very compassionate. Very thoughtful. Such benevolence that we could have created isness, but we decided, nah, we're not going to do it. We're going to cut God a break. Awesome compassion there. So you get these kind of teachers that are full of compassion and love and all this stuff. And they said, yeah, I decided I'm not going to create isness. I managed to not do it. Of course, I could always change. They always change my mind if you slack on the worshiping. You know, the idols idols are a double-edged sword for sure. Idolatry is uneasy. So this one's hitting real heavy and hard and intense for sure, which is exactly what we want. So all praise to the Holy Spirit and His efforts on our behalf to be able to get to this, because that's what we want. What we're here is to make progress, make rapid progress. Because I have said, 2/16, July of 2/16, is a drop dead time in terms of. The ways of this world crystallizing, but you don't want to get caught up in that. So we want to make rapid progress. And certainly because our misery too, we're miserable, we want to make rapid progress. So all praise to the Holy Spirit for bringing this rapid progress to us. And certainly I can feel this is way more important than sitting down reading a book. I don't care what book it is. Even if it's A Course in Miracles, Bhagavad Gita, you name it, the simple recognition here carries way more weight. It's very intense. It's almost like inescapable. You know, when you read a whole book, so many thoughts come up and you feel you can escape everywhere, this thought, that thought. Here, you know, this feels like very inescapable. It's like in the sauna, the door's closed, you know, it's hot. There's no escape from it. So keep it simple. The simpler it is, the more we feel, well, it's just inescapable. So this is great, great good news. We're making super rapid progress, actually, which is exactly what we need. We didn't even know this was there, did we? It's come up a number of times. I've been able to see it. But nobody even imagines that it's there at all, right? This circularity of looping back and creating so this infinite regress. You seem like you're trapped, can't get out of it. Reaction in my nose to sneeze. Just overcame it. Wow. And I reached a point like I'm gonna lose. And I just made this intense, willful decision. says, I am not going to sneeze. It's not going to happen. And poof, it vanished. Just vanished like that. Wow. This is like shifting to the level of real thought, of real creativity. I felt I was, the body was in control, and I could, nothing I could do with my thoughts to stop it, and I shifted to will. I shifted into will right then. I said, this will not happen. This will not happen. And then whew, gone. Wow. We had this man in this area up in the hills somewhere. I never saw him, but it was Christopher Hills, I think. He wrote a lot of esoteric stuff about light and all that stuff, and dowsing. He was quite a dowser. He was kind of a mini heavyweight in terms of esoteric stuff and all this. He wrote in one of his books, he wrote that he was, I think he was trying to like help his child who was in danger or something. And somehow he cut off his thumb or he had some accident. And he realized, he simply said, I can't be dysfunctional now because I have to help my child. There's something along this line. And somehow he just shifted into will. And he just like put his thumb back on or something like that. And it just was healed just like that. This is not going to, this situation, my will is that this situation return to normalcy, my functionality. Well, yeah, I believed him. I believe what he said. There's actually, in India, there's a word for this kind of thing. They have words for everything. They're spiritual, don't they? Zagi, something, some guy. There's lots of stories about, like, when Alexander the Great conquered India, and there was some guru, some yogi there on the banks of some river or something, and Alexander decided to return back and wait for the river to subside after the monsoon season. And his teacher in Greece had told him that he was going to meet some guru. When you get to India, when you get to the far lands, right, when you can't go any further, look for these holy sages, and ask them for truth. Ask them. So he said, wow, maybe this is what I'm looking for. And so he went to ask the sage, you know, what should I do? What's your advice? And the sage says, you're going to die very soon. Go home. And he got furious. He had quite a temper. And he told his guards, his bodyguards, whatever, to kill the guru. So they went to seize the guru, and they couldn't move the guru. So they like grabbed his arms, tried to tug it, and his arm just came off. Just pulled his arm right off his body. They grabbed the other one, pulled his other arm off his body. They grabbed his legs came off. Pulled another leg, another leg came off. So he was like limbless, but still somehow just sitting there without any limbs. And then somehow, you know, the limbs just kind of like came back and just reattached themselves to his body. He just kept sitting there like nothing had ever happened. But this isn't the only account of this. This has been accounted for robbers, you know, come. Try to rob a guru walking the forest. They come with a sword and hack off the arm or something to take something, and the guru just keeps walking like nothing happened. Or they chop off his head and just keeps walking, and the head just kind of floats and just reattaches itself or something. So they have a name for this, you know, in India. Well, it's simply shifting at will. They're at the level of will, spiritual will. So, their body is just an appearance. I mean, everything's just an appearance, what they want to experience. So, arm attached, arm unattached, there's no difference, just an appearance. They're not at the level of the thoughts of the brain, you see. They're at the level of the oneness, the will, spiritual will. This is what I want to experience. This is my will. This is the desire of experiencing. Something like that. So we can experience this in a minor way by these irritations that come, these itches, these scratches, the desire to sneeze, and we feel like we can't stop that. But if you feel, if I sneeze, I'm going to die. It was like, that is that intense. I absolutely cannot sneeze or I'm going to die. And suddenly I shifted into this feeling of will. And again, kryptonite. Kryptonite for the sneeze. So we battle with all the problems, but we never don't shift into a level of will. So what we're doing here, full stop in the now, in the burn, in the wow, is getting closer to will. This is something we have to say, you know, it's life or death. I have to just do not elaborate. Do not spin it. Don't spin it. Question, how did I create isness? And how did I not create it? Don't spin it. Don't elaborate, don't spin it. If we can think, if I spin it, I'm going to die. Well, I'm going to sink back into ignorance for sure. Original will is effortless. It's the will to try to defeat original will. It feels like so much full of effort. Like the will to manage to not create isness. I have a gigantic accomplishment. The ersatz guru, the one that has this, I've accomplished the ultimate. I have managed to not create isness. The ultimate accomplishment. Actually, there is no accomplishment whatsoever. There's no accomplishment to talk about whatsoever. As soon as we spin that, what do we spin it to? Accomplishment, of course. We say, hey, I've managed to not accomplish any accomplishment. Immediately back in duality, see? Immediately back in accomplishment. You see this shift there? When we realize, oh, there are no accomplishments at all, none. In fact, there's not even the notion of accomplishment, neither accomplishment nor non-accomplishment. But as soon as we say, hey, that's great. I've managed to not accomplish anything. That's right back into the belief of an accomplishment. And then we get mad at reality. Why did reality run away from me? You know, why did non-duality flee from me? That's not right. Come on back. I'm not that bad. You know what I'm saying? Come on back. This is what happens. This is exactly what happens. Many have asked me, you know, I've had this experience where I saw I abide in non-dual reality. I've had this, you know, awakening, but I lost it. I lose it. I find I lose it. Okay, so this is the same experience I've had. And so what we're doing is we're addressing this here. Why? Why? How do we lose it? And now we're seeing, very tricky, huh? How we lose it. We take credit for not taking credit. We take credit for not taking credit. We say, wow, I managed to accomplish no accomplishment. So what we say, it's inherently, reality is inherently the way it is. It doesn't require any non-accomplishment. See that? Reality isness is inherently the way it is. It doesn't require any non-accomplishment. You know, it's like the light battling the dark. The light. I say, what are you doing, light? And light says, well, I'm battling this accomplishment, getting rid of this accomplishment, so I can say I've managed to not have any accomplishment. I have to get rid of this. This. I have to get rid of this desire for accomplishment. To not accomplish. Or maybe the darkness represents that I'm managing to not accomplish anything. And the light is desire to accomplish. You might have a battle of light and dark. Light says, I must accomplish something. And the dark says, no, I must not accomplish. I must manage to not accomplish anything. Let it sink in. This is very powerful. Don't try to extrapolate it too much. Don't spin it. Because whatever help this is, it will come out of its own accord as long as we get comfortable with this. Is this a key to awakening? Absolutely. No question. I can see it very plainly, but don't spin it. Don't jump. Say, okay, what is it? I gotta accomplish that. No. So there's the two sides of this delusion, light and dark, isn't there? Oh, how did I accomplish isness? What accomplishment brought about this isness? And the other is, oh, what non-accomplishment brought about this isness? See? Like that. What I see that the world going into is this trap of believing in managing to not accomplish. You see, managing, oh, I managed to not accomplish. Isness. I managed to not create isness. This is the fourth dimensional trap, or something. It's a trap. This is how I see the world going into this. So many of these teachers and various voices, spiritual voices in the world, are actually headed into that, leading the world into that. Pipers leading the world in, leading our attention into that, thinking that it's the age of enlightenment. It's not. It's a dualistic trap. So when I keep speaking to this, speaking, I point out, hey, this, see, this is an example, there are examples everywhere of this. We're going from this motif of accomplishment to the motif of supposed non-accomplishment, see? That's the spin in the world right now, very, very much so. This is what we must see through, and we are seeing through right now. But don't struggle with it. The help comes from not struggling. Use the will here to not struggle. And they will say, well, there's no way then. There's no way. Yeah. They say, well, how did I manage to not have a way? That's still a way, isn't it? The way of no way. That's still a way. There's neither way nor the way of no way. Neither. There's neither a path nor not a path. Someone will say, well, there's no path. They say, wow, yeah, I got rid of the path. No, there's never been a path. You can't get rid of what's never been. So to tackle this consciously is very, very significant and important. We get glimpses of this. Sometimes we're able to see into it in deep contemplation or something, but to be able to just easily look at this consciously like this is very important. It's tremendous. Just don't spin it. Try to say, well, this means that. I can apply it to this. I can apply it to that. That's spinning. Don't spin it at all. See, again, isness has no opposites at all, not even a hint of it. Doesn't have path and no path. Doesn't have accomplishment and no accomplishment. Doesn't exist there, not at all. There's no suggestion of that. So nothing has to be resolved between path and no path, between accomplishment and non-accomplishment. Nothing has to be settled or resolved at all. There isn't any issue there. There's no battle. You know, then you see, it's like we have this battle between those who say, there's a way to create business. Existence can do it. And others say, no, we have to manage to not do it. So the ones say, no, we need to manage to do it, and the other ones need to manage to not do it. They're in conflict, and we think that the victor is the answer, and there's something up at stake. There's nothing at stake. There's no conflict at all. So seeing that there's no conflict, Ramana wasn't solving any conflict. Peace is not the solving of conflict. In peace, there's no hint or suggestion of conflict or non-conflict. Isness just is. It's not predicated on a lack of conflict between isness and not isness. Nothing like that. Again, avoid thinking about success, spinning it like that way. No, just sit and how does it feel to be aware of this? How does it feel to be aware of this? And not so much how, but just full stop. Whatever the feeling is, just don't do anything about it. Don't even label it. Staggered mind. That's the feeling. It's beyond what we can think about, really. It's more profound. This is so profound. Don't even try to chase it after it. This is like throwing a mountain in a lake. I mean, the reverberations are just splashing everywhere. Just let it splash. Don't try to assess all the reverberations or count them or label them or categorize them. Just basically say, okay, I just dropped a mountain in the lake. And there's a lot of reverberations. So I'll just sit here quietly until they settle down, like that. There's nothing you can really do to hasten it. They'll settle down on their own accord, right? All the ripples of dropping something into a body of water. That will subside. It will settle down. So we drop this mountain and it dissolves. Eventually there's nothing left to drop into the water. You see, there's nothing left. We have all this stuff suspended above the water. We're dropping one at a time, bit by bit, we're dropping it in. Eventually we'll look up, there's nothing suspended there at all. It's clear, completely clear. Now, I said in 1978, we essentially woke up. Once we see that the continuity problem is the only problem there is, we're essentially liberated. It's the end of the ego. I realize that, this is it. But, imagine if there's this fan, ceiling fan, in your room, and it's going really, really, really fast. Super, super fast. You pull the chain, you turn that electricity off to it. What happens? Seemingly nothing, right? Now, that fan is going fast enough. You may sit there for years, and you look at the fan and you say, God, nothing's happening. Well, you know? Or you look at it and say, well, maybe it seems to be going a little slower. More years pass, and you look at it again, and you say, it's definitely not quite as fast as it used to be. You know, decade past, another decade. You look at the fan, you say, it's no question it has slowed down to some extent, but it's still going fast. So and maybe there's still some electricity going to it, I'm not sure. Then, more effort, and you look at it now, it's like, you say, wow, it is much slower. You know, but we say, maybe it's just slowed down, but it's not stopped. Maybe the electricity is still going. So now there's been a progressive slowing down of the fan. And then you start thinking, maybe it is off. Maybe the fan is off. And so now it's just going, you know, real slow like this. And so you just sit there, don't do anything. Just let it come to a stop. So it may take a long time from when you wake up and realize, oh my gosh, okay, see that through the delusion, and then it gradually slows down. So we have all these confusions suspended above this lake, and one at a time we're dropping them into the lake, and then each practice session we drop another one in, and we just sit there and let the lake calm down. Thought. I knew I'm going to be called. And I said, nah, that can't be right. Boom. It happened. All right. I didn't want to say anything. I didn't want to seem like a fool, you know, say, I think I'm going to get a phone call right now. Yeah, then nothing happens. Happens to me a lot. I always seem to be aware when a phone call is going to come in. Like, I say, oh, man, I think I'm getting a phone call right now. And then, like, the second later. Interesting. What to make of it? Nothing. Doesn't matter. This often happens with significant others, you know, that you're so in tune that you know when they're gonna call. You know, just know it. And then they go just like that. It's mind readers, say it's mind readers, yeah. But actually, we can be this way with everything. When we don't see anyone as special, but all as one, we're aware of everything that's happening and going to happen. What, you know, I used to be when young like that, and some of us are like that. And then we're told, well, see, that means you're really specially in tune with someone. So that's a special someone for you. And you need to pursue the specialness. Is that the special one for you? As if it's somehow supposed to be limited to just one person or something. And then you feel wrong if you know, you have some special relationship, and then you say, someone's going to call me and say, hey, I thought you're only supposed to know when I'm going to call you. So you think they're special too, huh? You know, and then, you know how that goes. This is the claws of existence, you know, tearing into us. <It's> But this, what we've done here, is super important. Don't even try to evaluate it. Just sit. Just let the reverberations. Okay, great, great. If you ask, is this far along? It's far along for sure. We don't say how far along. But is this rapid progress? It is very rapid progress. How rapid? We won't say how rapid. Don't get into measurement calculations so much. Don't spin it. Just say, okay. Just, you know, it's like, wow. You can just tell, wow. Don't compare. No spin, no comparison. Full stop. No spin, no comparison, no past, no future, no parallel, no storyline, no script, no labeling, no exception, no exemption, no residue. Just full stop, just here. Let the lake calm down. Let the lake calm down, let the lake calm down. Whew, it's like that. I'll carry this with me to the end of the evening and see how it goes. Don't push the river. Don't try to just let it all settle down. We're right on it. We're right on it. Don't worry. We're right on it. The schedule, you know, July 216, we're right on schedule. Right on schedule. Just don't spin it. Don't try to make it more. Don't try to make it less. Don't do anything. Just kind of let it be. Let it be. Let it be. All right. Very great. That's it.